what I wanted to do was to help set kind of the context and give you some of the background of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, because you may not be aware of this background and of what we do, all the things that we do. So we've been funded pretty much continuously since 1987 by the Bureau of Health Professions. This is a long-standing funding pattern that we've had. We've been very fortunate to have that. And during that time, we've had a primary mission of infusing, developing curriculum on ethnogeriatrics, developing knowledge, but most importantly, disseminating it broadly to three primary audiences. So we have faculty like yourselves, healthcare providers, and also students who are training in the health professions. We want them to be exposed to this topic of ethnogeriatrics, and you'll hear more about what that means exactly. Gwen will be covering that, I believe, in her talk. So we won't need to go into too much of a definition right now, but we also want to be a local and a national resource center on this particular issue. So we have big ambitions, and we've accomplished a certain amount of this over time, but there's always more to do, and so we're excited to have you as partners with us this coming year. So we're going into year 5 of our current funding pattern, and in this year 5, and for the past few years, including this last year, this is our last year of guaranteed funding, we have several initiatives, and I thought it might be useful for you to know what they are. So the first is evidence-based practices, disseminating information on evidence-based practices to faculty, providers, and students. So HRSA, this Bureau of Health Professions that governs the geriatric education centers nationally, came up with a list of evidence-based practices that the GECs were invited to choose from. And we selected 2, diabetes and depression. And in diabetes, we're particularly focused on the chronic care model, disseminating more information about that chronic care model to providers and also, in this case, to patients. And the mechanism is around foot care. That's the particular content area. So it's assessing the status of the foot and looking for diabetic neuropathies, and then what can the patient do and the provider do if this is discovered or not, what education can be provided. In terms of depression, we're looking at a particular program that incorporates the PHQ-9, which is a quick tool to assess depressive symptoms that probably many of you use or have heard of, as well as an intervention program based in cognitive behavior therapy, which is called behavioral activation. And we've had much more success with the diabetes program than we have had with the depression program. And so I'd be happy to talk with any of you about that more if you're interested. Also, of course, the faculty development program that you are here for, the 160-hour program that's offered by other GECs as well. But ours is the only one that focuses in the particular topical areas that we do. We also have partnerships with San Jose State University, various departments within the university, to train students who are in the pipeline to become health providers. So you see certain professions represented there that unfortunately are not here at Stanford, which is why we need to have the partnership with San Jose State. And we're looking into partnerships with other universities and community colleges as well, because there's only a certain number of disciplines that are represented here. As you can see, there are many that are not represented. We also have a clerkship that's not included there in that exposes medical students to principles of geriatric medicine and some issues about geriatric medical care here at Stanford. And then we offer programs in ethnogeriatrics to providers in underserved areas. And we've primarily done that through a series of webinars that we've created for the last few years. The webinars are archived, so this makes them convenient for providers to access because they can access them on demand. So that seems to be a lot easier for people than showing up at a particular time for a certain lecture or workshop. And you are welcome to visit the website if you have, I'm sure you have already, but you might not have noticed all the webinars that are there. You might want to go through some of the topics. You might find them of interest to you. End of life and spiritual care has been a long-standing initiative of this particular GEC, particularly as it relates to diversity issues. So how do end of life practices differ according to cultural, ethnic, racial groups? And then emergency preparedness, we're part of a collaborative that is addressing that on a national level. Emergency preparedness is a huge issue, particularly in long-term care settings, but it's also a huge issue in ethnically diverse communities where it may not be a topic that is addressed as often as it might be in the white non-Hispanic white communities. So we have two webinars per year. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. And then lastly, dementia and family caregiving. We've partnered with our local Alzheimer's Association for a number of years to put on an annual conference that usually has a specific theme to it. This year, our theme was on traumatic brain injury and how that can ultimately lead to Alzheimer's disease. You know, what the relationship is between traumatic brain injury earlier in life and Alzheimer's disease later in life. And our part of our contribution to these conferences each year is to have a diversity focus. So this year we had a panel that focused on specific groups. Often we do. So again, if you want to learn more about these conferences, you can reach them through YouTube. They are on a YouTube site, and there's access available through our main website. So the dementia and family caregiving one has really taken off in the last year, and it's going to continue to be a big topic because of the NAPA plan, that national plan to address Alzheimer's disease that was passed by President Obama in 2012. It's been updated since then, 2013, 2014. The NAPA plan provided some additional funding for many things. You may be aware that there's more funding for research in some of the basic genetic aspects of Alzheimer's. There's funding for clinical trials that there wasn't before. They're fast-tracking a number of new drugs because it's a huge issue. I'll talk about this more when I do my presentation on Thursday afternoon. But right now, just so you get an idea that this is an expanding initiative that we receive supplemental funding for. And so in our final year, in our fifth year, we have, I think it's six new things that we're doing that pertain to this particular area, Alzheimer's and related dementias. The first of them is local training, believe it or not. There's an awful lot of people right here in our own backyard who have limited knowledge and exposure to this topic. We actually do have a memory clinic, which is kind of a point of entry for people into the system who are concerned about whether or not they might have Alzheimer's or some other form of dementia, but it's not... It's understaffed, and it's extremely high demand, and so a lot of the needs of people in this region are actually not being met at the present time. So education of local providers, we think, will help with that. The LGBT community is very interested in the topic of dementia because so many participants in that community are living longer, and they had developed a type of dementia sometimes from their HIV symptoms or from their treatment, so that over time, if they didn't have a full-blown dementia, oftentimes by the time they're in their 60s or 70s, they do. And this is a community that's been almost exclusively underserved in this regard. There's been very little attention to dementia in the LGBT community and to the family caregivers or friend and partner caregivers. So we've established a partnership with several local agencies, and we have a conference in the planning stage that will be offered in February. Our third initiative is our online course in ethnicity and dementia. So some of you may be aware that Gwen and I co-edited a book on ethnicity and dementia a few years back. probably needs a new edition. It was in a second edition, probably needs a third edition. So we've also offered a number of webinars on different ethnic groups and how they respond to the issue of dementia, what some of the family dynamics are, some of the assessment issues. So the online course, you will be helping us to pilot that course, and you'll hear more about that again when I talk about the topic of dementia on Thursday. We have an introduction that has three parts to it. We have a module in primary care, and then we have eight other modules focused on specific groups that are completed. That's on the left side, and then ones that are in the planning stage and that will be completed. So we'll be adding to them. And perhaps other topics will come up and we'll want to add some others that we don't see up there right now. For instance, the LGBT community isn't there because there's not enough information yet. But we think perhaps in another year or so there will be, and so that will be added. The online course we thought would be a way for providers to get a lot of information in one place in a short period of time. And if it is successful, we would offer continuing education units with the course. So that's in the quite a bit is developed, but more is still being developed. Our next one is to provide webinars on emergency preparedness with regard to dementia. So again, emergency preparedness has focused on audiences in general or patients in need, but not on dementia patients. And in our case, it's dementia patients of various racial and ethnic groups. So it's even more specific. And we're partnered with the Centers for Disease Control to create this and offer it in this grant year. The most recent one was very well attended on June 16th. Again, it's an archived webinar now, so you're welcome to access it. We had excellent national speakers, and I think you would find it interesting if this is a topic that you don't know a lot about. This would be a great introduction to it. And the last two initiatives, the Muslim and South Asian communities are growing in this region, in this Bay Area. And again, they are relatively underserved in terms of both healthcare provision in general, but in regard to dementia, very little is known. Very little is known. There's virtually no empirical research. If you look for case studies, you can hardly even find them. But they are in our region, and they have come to us to ask for assistance in learning more about dementia and caregiving issues related to assessments. So we are partnering with professionals, and we'll see where that goes. That is a really challenging initiative because these are cultures that are very hidden in regards to dementia or anything like that. That it's not well acknowledged in these communities. And finally, with our website, we're trying to grow our website, and we thought one thing that would be helpful for providers from around the country would be to see the GEC website as a hub, a place where you can go for basic measures that have to do with dementia. Remember, this is all part of that dementia initiative that I mentioned. So not only get them in English, but get them in other languages so that you don't have to go searching over the web, you know, well, where do I find Russian? Is there a Russian version of the MOCA? Is there a Russian PHQ-9, you know, if you're interested in that? Is there a Vietnamese version of the caregiver questionnaire? So it's not only assessment, but issues related to dementia in these different languages. And we hope that will be a useful resource. And we're very open to suggestions for other instruments that you might be aware of or other languages that you think we've missed that would be pertinent. We have a very able student with us this summer who has been volunteering, Dongmei Tan. Dongmei, where are you? Yes, thank you. Dongmei has done some research already, locating instruments that are available and also showing us where the gaps are. So we're very excited about that project. Nothing is up yet because we're not ready to put anything up yet. But in the year ahead, I think you'll find that will be in existence and hopefully will be useful. And that was about it in terms of what I wanted to say. I wanted to show you some pictures that we've taken of some of our group experiences, events, training programs, that type of thing. So I think you get an idea of the diversity within our own staff, as well as the diversity with amongst the people that we serve. And for further information, there's our website. It's very simple. Can't miss it. However, if you put in geriatrics, okay, if you just put in geriatrics, for example, Stanford and geriatrics, you'll get a whole lot of other things, okay? You won't necessarily get us. So it would be very helpful if you memorize these initials, you know, SGEC, and then you will always be able to find us, okay? All right, so thank you for your attention, and back to Gwen, who is our MC this morning, right?
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Laura.
You're welcome. Oh.